Hi, I'm Jen Kramer, Director of Learning Design and Technology at Annie Cannons. In this CSS-based course, we will be building a portfolio website working with only HTML and CSS. We'll be using all of the latest techniques with CSS, including CSS variables or custom properties, the focus and focus within pseudo selectors, and of course, it's all responsive. By the end of this course, you will wind up with a portfolio that'll showcase all of your best work in a really wonderful way. I'm really excited to get started, so let's begin. So let's start by setting up the colors for our web page. Inside of the class website, you'll see that I've given you a series of colors here. Those, of course, are hex values that we're going to use for those colors. They are what our designer has picked out for us to use in this particular design. So one of the first things that we always do is we start by setting these up as CSS variables, or the more appropriate name is CSS custom properties. And the way that we do that, and I usually put mine right up here at the very start of the web page, we're going to give this a selector called root, R-O-O-T, with a colon in front of it. What does root mean?
The one location that everything connects to.
The one location, it's the root, the very base of the document, right? Everything is derived from this base of the document. And by putting our, setting up our custom properties or our variables here, we make them globally available everywhere in the document. And when it comes to colors and fonts, that is absolutely what you want to do. So we will start by giving these names, and we can debate how you name your particular variables. In a lot of cases, people advocate calling them like primary color and secondary color and all the rest of that, because what happens if one day you go from blue to purple and you now have a variable called blue, which has a value of purple? So that might be something you want to think about, but to keep things simple, I am going to call my variables by the color names. You set up a variable by putting a double dash in front of it, and then we're going to give it a name like black, with a colon after it, and then we give it our value, 000501, and a semicolon at the end. Okay? Absolutely nothing is going to change on your web page. Don't panic. It's totally fine. And that is, we're just setting up these variables right now. We haven't actually set them up to display. Okay? I'll show you how to do white. So I'm going to call this one white. And this one is FF, 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 okay? All right, we've got four more to go here. Take 2 minutes and type in all the rest of those there into your root declaration. So hopefully you have a series of variables that are set up like this. Remember that variables, just like everything else in code, do not like spaces, do not like funny characters. So when you come to a name like light green, you want to make it all one word, light green. So now let's look at your code. What have you got so far? You have variables for colors and you have boxes. How do we connect those colors in the variables with the boxes that currently have no color? How are we going to put those two things together? Those of you who know how variables work in any other programming language, what do you need to do? Anybody have a suggestion?
Someone's saying dash dash var.
Interesting idea. Yes. So not dash dash, but we need to put this together somehow. We have to declare our various variables. So the way we're going to do that is we're going to set up a series of classes, because we already have those classes there in our HTML. So we're going to say white. And then I'm going to say background color is this var that the guy just mentioned, var dash dash white. And that was a really bad one to start with, so let's just do another one real quick, because you won't be able to see that, of course. So I'm just going to copy paste that and make this black with a background color of black. And now we have one square with color. Okay, so what just happened here? We have our class, which is white, black, tan, green, and light green. And we've set it up to have a background color, a CSS property. And we're saying declare it as the value of this variable, which I established up here at the top of my document, And this is the way we make our variables appear. We say var, and then inside of the parentheses, we say the name of our variable, in this case, the color. So we're just gonna copy paste because we've made this easy for ourselves by calling these all the same things. And let's just go through and change these colors. So we have tan and tan. Green and green. Light green and light green. Oops. And red and red. Now that you've seen how you can get an SVG from a site like Font Awesome and include it in your web page, make it accessible, and you, of course, already know how to work with text and background images on a web page, it's time for you to take a stab at this next exercise. So the last thing I'd like for you to do here in Chapter 3 is to try building the footer here on your own. So starting with the opening code pen, make sure you put in your information, like your name and the title that you're going to have. Add your icons for LinkedIn, GitHub, email, whatever else you want to add. And then mark it up, add your styling, and see if you can make your footer look like the footer that I am showing here. So let me go through what I've got for code and so forth. So this is the footer of the web page. So a great way to mark that up is with the footer element. So there we are, there's the footer element. Inside of that, we have a div with a class of container. So this is just like we have been doing throughout the course where we had that outside section, except in this case, it happens to be the footer instead of a section element. And then we have our div with a class of container. The name Jen Creamer plus my title seem to be pretty important down here in the footer, so I've marked that up with an H2. Then I have my list of links. So here's all the ways that you can contact me. And you'll see here that these are set up pretty much the same way. So here's the LinkedIn one with a link to my LinkedIn page and then the ARIA label of LinkedIn so that people who are using screen readers will know what it is. And then of course, in the SVG itself, we wanna set the ARIA hidden to true so that we skip over those SVGs and the screen reader doesn't try to read it, okay. And so we repeat that same process with GitHub and then with email. Remember again, the email link is slightly different. That's going to be mail2: with your email address and then ARIA label of email. You'll have to go to Font Awesome to go download that SVG, but I showed you how to do that earlier. And then finally, at the very end of everything here, I have my copyright statement. And what the way that I've marked that up is with a paragraph, and I've actually used the small HTML element. Now, the small element was something that was frowned upon for a really long period of time. Of course, was invented back when small meant make the text small. Today, that small has now been repurposed into a meaning that means this is like the fine print. So this would be the legalese at the bottom of your web page or and the copyright statement, something that's not necessarily all that important, but legally we've got to put it there. So there you go. There's my copyright statement. So that's why I use the small element for that. If you didn't use the small element for yours, absolutely fine. It's fine with just a paragraph. Notice that as I make my page bigger and smaller, that image does change a little bit here. I have a little trick in the CSS that's going on that shows you different parts of the image as I change this. So let's look at the CSS for that piece of it. Okay, so here in the footer, I have my layer of footer that's set up here automatically. And then inside of that, we have my footer style. Very similar to the other sections that we've seen before. I'm centering my text, I've added some padding. I gave it a background color of black just in case, for whatever reason, the image doesn't load quickly. Then we have the image itself. Don't repeat it, center it on the page. The line of code that makes it do this thing where it's showing different parts of the image is this line right here, background size of cover. And so what that's going to do is basically take the image that's here and resize it such that it's filling in the space that's available to it. Because the dimensions of that the viewport here are changing, it needs different amounts of image in order to show. And that's why, like, when it gets small like this, you can actually see the island and the sunset down here at the bottom, as opposed to when it is wide, when you see just the stars on the top. If you didn't have that line of code, that's not the end of the world. What it would look like is this. Instead, you would see the stars swirling around, and it would pretty much be the same no matter what. You would just have the swirl kind of scrolling off the side of the screen. And that works absolutely fine as well. There's nothing wrong with that. But I just really like the sunset down at the bottom. So I added that line of code, which dealt with the layout of that image a little bit differently. Then finally, down here at the bottom, we have our footer UL. So of course, I had all of my icons inside of a list. So we did all the same things that we did before with the navigation bar. We've turned off the padding, and I guess I've left a little bit of margin on the top and bottom so that those icons stand out. We've set them up with Flexbox. They show up in a row. They have a little bit of a gap in between them so that we have plenty of room for clickability. We have made our SVGs turn white, and they are green when you hover over them. And that pretty much takes care of the footer for the web page. With our media queries here, we have our first media query. We're going to add another media query at media, and this will be max width 667 pixels. So here, bottom grid will have a gap of 2 rem. So that's the first thing that we need to do. Make sure that our gap is got kind of big there. Remember we had, I think it was like a 6 rem gap in the row, and they were kind of spread out all over the page. So now I'm setting the gap to an even 2 rem for all of those. And then for bottom grid A, in other words, the links, right now those are set to 30% each, okay, which is why they're still in this configuration. I'm now going to set my flex basis to 80%. So in other words, make it take over most of that particular area and fill it with the picture. So there it is, okay? And obviously that, as we make it smaller, it continues to look better. Now let's take a look at the top grid here. Yeah, because I did the top grid on tablet, but I did not do the top grid on mobile. So a few modifications that we want to make on the top grid on mobile. And so what we're going to do is, for 667 pixels here, for top grid figure, let's put a margin bottom of 2 rem. Okay, so in other words, we're just continuing to tighten a little bit of space here. It was larger, I think it was 4 rem at tablet, so we're just tightening this up a little bit here, and particularly to match the images that are going to come after. The other thing is, projects that I am proud of gets a little bit big at this particular screen dimension, so I am going to add to this a section-projects H2, and I'm going to change my font size to var H5. And these figure captions, once again, the CSS projects text and advanced CSS layouts, these titles get a little bit big, so we may want to reduce those as well. Fig caption H3. Font size, var, base size. So let's make them a little bit smaller. And so that's great. That looks much better now when we get down to these mobile dimensions.